We just had first thing I saw was a $48 million settlement on a mold on mold.
It was a mold case where somehow mold was growing in, I think it was an apartment condo scenario. And we had this older lady who was living there who complained about it. I believe other people had complained about it. And the owner just said, don't care. And this lady had some health issues from mold. You know, health issues from mold, it's one of these weird things where it's almost like if people hear that mold is somewhere that they are at, they almost somewhat mentally convince themselves that they have health issues, right? So in those kind of cases, you need a doctor. You need an actual professional, somewhat of an expert to say, yes, this issue you have is mold, not all the other things that could cause this issue. Sinuses, seasonal allergies, yada, yada, yada. So I think they had that. I mean, from what I know of that case, there was some significant damage that happened to this lady. So that's rare in a mold case. You normally do not see high level of injury, but they had it. And 48 million, does that really justly compensate someone who had mold injuries? Man, I think the jury was just mad. I think they were really, really mad at some landlord, you know, it's kind of like slumlord kind of deal, who wouldn't fix whatever the issue was that led to the mold.
We spoke about that the other day with big verdicts and how they come down with that. And it's usually compassion from the jury.
It's more anger, man. It's all about anger. I mean, I can have the greatest, most lovable client. I represented this lady, one of the sweetest people ever. Okay. She worked at a company called Head Start. I think they do like pre-K teaching and
Heard of it?
mentorship, right? You know, it's like a really, the mission statement of that particular organization is like a great mission statement. It's like, yeah, it's exactly what we want people to do. You know, it's help these kids get ready for school, help these kids get ready for life. So she worked there, sweet lady, very nice lady. She gets involved in a horrific car accident. So this is what happens. She lives over in Santa Rosa and she would take I-10 into Pensacola to go to her job. They were doing tons and tons of work by Avalon, kind of the foot of the bridge coming into Santa Rosa, okay? And one of these construction companies had this massive truck basically just sitting in the median. And I have no idea where this guy was trying to go or what he was trying to do, but he just pulls his truck right into the lanes of 10. Just right there, okay? My client's doing, who knows, 70, 75? Like what you would be doing on I-10, and just smacks the side of this massive truck. It's crazy because the injury she had, you would expect to be more significant, but she most certainly had a broken wrist. It's an injury we'll see sometimes. They had to put a plate in her wrist, and you know, it's significant for her age. She was early 20s, having a plate in your wrist for the rest of your life. So, that case, even though she was the sweetest lady, and I put her in front of a jury, I can talk about all the great stuff she has doing and is doing and will do, but that's not going to get me any money. What really was going to get me money is whether or not this dude was drunk, because there was some evidence that he was drunk. So what happens in a big trucking accident, what we call a CDL accident, you know, someone who has a CDL license, if they are in an accident where someone has to go to the hospital, they have to give a sample of something. Normally it's a breath sample, so it can be blood sample. They have to give a sample to verify that they're not under the influence. And what happened in this case is the dude refused.
When you cause injury, where does that take you? Because you have to by
Yeah.
law.
I think he lost his CDL for like a brief period of time. But you got to imagine, you know, we're not talking about someone coming home from a bar. We're talking about 8 o'clock in the morning. This dude, for whatever reason, just pulls this massive truck right there in the middle of 10, causes a bad accident, and then refuses to give blood. And what I went in front of the judge, I said, hey judge, look, you know, if this was a DUI case, this guy refusing to give a sample is what a prosecutor would tell the jury. A prosecutor would go in front of the jury and say, and that guy refused to give a breath sample. And you know what that means? He refused to do it because he knew that it would show that he was drunk. So I went in front of the judge and said, listen, you know, this dude refused to give a sample. If this was a DUI case, that's absolutely admissible to prove that this dude was DUI or that he thought he was DUI. So, judge, we need to punish this guy. The judge over in Santa Rosa said no. It was mind-blowing. Because that same judge, look, that same judge, if it was a DUI case and I was representing the DUI driver and I went to court and said, no, judge, let's keep out that my client refused to give a breath sample or refused to give a blood sample, that judge would laugh at me. Be like, what are you talking about, Mr. Crawford? Of course that's coming into evidence.
Does the officers have to bring that up, like, on scene? You know, does all that...
Yes.
It blows my mind that he got away with not having blood drawn or any kind of sample after causing injury in the first place, but because it was in the morning.
Yeah, so normally what happens in the trunk driving scenario is the company has to abide by certain federal regulations. Like, the company has to do random testing. The company has to have programs to make sure that the people who are driving are capable of driving. So to me, that was kind of on the company. But also the trooper should have known, like, what do you mean you're not going to give a blood test? Where were you last night? You know? The dude wasn't here locally. He wasn't a local guy. He was brought in by this company from, I think he was from Jacksonville, somewhere around there, right? So you know he's staying at some hotel. Right? Staying by himself, more likely than not. It's not like he brought his whole family over. So it's like, where were you last night, my friend? McGuire's? Flounders? You know? And then it blows my mind that normal, just common sense sometimes evades law enforcement because they're so regimented in what they do. You know, the cop's like, okay, I got his license and registration. Now I'm going to go run it. Okay, everything's clear. Now I'm going to look at the citation. Okay, now I'm typing the citation. They don't think to themselves, why, man? You're refusing? Let's talk about that a little bit. They just don't do it. They don't take that extra step sometimes. And in that case, it was FHP, and they most certainly did not take that next step.
So what was the outcome for the lady, if you don't want me
asking? We settled for a good amount, an amount that she was happy with. But kind of bring this all back home, right? The settlement that we got was based upon the injuries that she had and how long these injuries will affect her. If I could have thrown more into the mix about the bad conduct of the driver, it would have put more money on the settlement. It absolutely would, because that is a driving factor. And it's crazy to think that way, because most certainly that driver was at fault. Like, he did something wrong, right? That's a given. But if I could have pointed the finger a little bit more, give a little bit more punishment, there could have been more money, possibly. The judge in that particular case just wouldn't let me do it.
So at night, if somebody is drinking and driving and they do hit and hurt somebody or hit or break something, can they refuse and then just walk like the way this guy did?
Certain scenarios. I mean, so you can always refuse a sample. So you can refuse to blow. You can refuse to give a urine sample. You can even refuse the blood sample. There are weird scenarios that play out. And one of the weird things is, let's say you get into an accident and you get taken to the hospital. The hospital is going to pull your blood for certain things if they have to treat you, okay? What happens is they can subpoena your medical records. Now, the medical blood versus BAC blood is a little bit different, okay? It's a different kind of blood draw, but they can do that. Now, what happens is because... very unfortunately, when we're talking about someone who's severely intoxicated, they will have accidents, right? They'll kind of fall within this very tragic scenario. The cops will go to the hospital, and a lot of them will tell the nurses, pull some blood. That happens more than people really realize. So there's a term that the cops and the nurses will discuss amongst each other that's kind of like a little wink, wink that the person's intoxicated. You probably need to pull blood, or we need to figure this out. And what they'll tell the cop is, hey, ETOH is on board. ETOH is E-T-O-H, and it basically means ethanol. So ethanol, alcohol, is what they're talking about. Like, hey, we did a screening, and a guy tested positive for ETOH. So he has some alcohol on board. So that's like the little conversation that's happening outside the room.